The molecular mechanistics of initiation of eukaryotic DNA replication is not just interesting, but it is a very highly coordinated process. Most of these molecular mechanistics have been studied in yeast as well as in metazoans, and a very distinctive picture of the replication initiation process is now available, although there are a lot of unanswered questions which are being explored all over the world. So let us look at the learning outcomes of this session. So in eukaryotes, it is ensured that the genome replicated once is replicated only once in a cell cycle, and this is correlated with initiation. For if initiation occurs only once, then the replication will occur only once. So therefore, the control of regulation is in ensuring that the initiation of replication occurs only once. Now, the initiation of DNA replication itself is a highly regulated process, and it has been well studied in Saccharomyces cerevisiae with involvement of several accessory proteins. The initiation occurs in two interconnected steps: licensing, which occurs in the G1 phase, and the firing, which occurs in the S phase. A deregulation of this, that is, if these steps are not happening at the coordinated phases of the cell cycle, then it has led to genomic instability. The initiation progresses from formation of pre-replication complex to pre-initiation complex, and then finally to forming the replication complex. And at the replication complex, when the replication complex is formed, the replisome contains all the three nuclear DNA polymerases as well. So now let us look at the entire process of initiation per se. So as mentioned earlier, there are two distinct interconnected steps, and the first step in leading to formation of the replication complex is what is called as licensing. So let us understand what we mean by licensing. Now let us consider that you have a eukaryotic DNA, a chromosome, which would have several origins of replication, for the simple reason that if there were only one origin of replication for one long DNA, it would take days to complete the replication of one DNA. So in order to hasten the process of the DNA replication, or enable the DNA replication to happen in a stipulated 11 to 15 hours as observed in the cell cycle, the presence of several origins of replication is important. What you see here are the replicators of the origins of replication. So we all know that for the initiation of replication, there has to be a replicator and there has to be an initiator. So what are the replicators? The replicators are cis elements, certain nucleotide sequences, especially they have been observed to be rich in 80 base pairs, with the understanding that if it is 80 base pairs, opening or unbinding of the DNA is more feasible. And therefore, although as you go higher into the higher eukaryotes, you may not find consensus and conserved sequences in the origin of replication, but in the yeasts, one definitely finds a structural feature of the origins of replication. So they have conserved sequences which enable the initiator to come and bind. Now, let us just consider one origin of replication and look at what happens at that origin, understanding that the same may be happening at all the origins. And again, it need not necessarily be all the origins, but wherever the initiator is able to go and bind, there the initiation will begin. Second important thing that is to be noted over here is that it has been reported that not all origins will open or fire or initiate at the same time. That is, it need not be synchronized. One may observe that certain origins begin at the initial phase of S phase, whilst there are certain which also begin late in the S phase. So these things are definitely there. Now let us look at what happens at the origin of replication. So considering that this is the replicator region, what has been observed is to this replicator region comes and binds a complex which is called as the origin replication complex. This origin replication complex has six subunits, ORC1 to ORC6. And interestingly, five of the ORCs except ORC6 have what is called as the AAA plus domain that is not only able to bind to ATP but also able to hydrolyze the ATP. So they have an inherent ATPase activity plus they are able to bind to ATP. The ORC1 being the biggest subunit of the ORC is now able to also bind to another molecule which is called as CDC6. Now, some reports suggest that it is CDC6 that is already bound to ORC complex and brings it to the replicator region, while some reports suggest that first the ORC comes and binds and then the CDC6 comes and binds to ORC1 to complete the circle. So this kind of forms a ring structure around the DNA. So the CDC6 is preferentially binding to ORC1, and as it binds to ORC1, it strengthens or increases the affinity with which the entire complex binds to the replicator region. Now, this CDC6 also has a binding domain to another molecule which is called CDT1. Now, this CDT1 is actually considered to be the replicative license factor. Now, the CDT1 has the ability to bind to the MCM227. So, MCM227 is a heterohexamer, okay, and it is basically the helicase. But when CDT1 binds to MCM2 and 6, especially MCM2 and 6 of the MCM27 complex, it is ensuring that the MCM27 is an open ringed structure. So when CDT1 comes and binds to the CDC6, due to the binding of CDT1 to CDC6, there is a conformational change in the ORC and the CDC6 that activates the ATPase activity of both the CDC6 and the ORC complex, and that activation of the ATPase ensures that ATP is being hydrolyzed. So the energy that is released helps CDT1 to load the open complexes of the MCM27 onto the replicator region. Now, what is interesting to note over here is that there are two CDT1s that can bring two MCM27 complexes, and these MCM27 complexes bind to each other head to head. So once the CDT1 comes and loads the helicase, okay, it is observed that one of the CDT1 goes, and there are two other, and the other CDT1 that is associated with the CDC6 is still bound. So this complex of ORC, CDC6, CDT1, and the inactive MCM27. Why is this considered to be inactive? Because in the open form, the MCM27 is a helicase that is not yet active. So this helicase, which is loaded in the replicator region, is bound to the replicator region, but it is not active as a helicase as yet. So this entire complex is what is called as the pre-replicative complex. And this formation of the pre-replicative complex is what is understood to be licensing. So effectively, what basically licensing is means is that now this origin is ready to open up. Okay, so the licensing happens the moment the MCM27 is loaded onto the replicator region. Now, this takes place either late mitosis or in the early G1 phases itself. And therefore, there is a catch over here. The catch is that this is the beginning of the regulation to ensure that replication in a cell cycle happens only once. We will understand that in the next, just in a few minutes, okay? But this is something that is very crucial. And also the fact that the licensing step, which is one of the interconnected steps, happens only in the G1 phase. So therefore, effectively what is understood is that the DNA or the genome of the cell is kept ready for initiation. As soon as the cell goes to the S phase of the cell cycle, it can begin initiation. So all these origins are marked up by the pre-replicative complex. So what does the pre-replicative complex actually do? So lysing achieves origin recognition, that is number one. ATP dependent loading of the MCM27 helicase, this actually is what is responsible for lysing, and it is always present as an inactive double hexamer. And what is important is that the orientation of the MCM27 being in the as head to head is basically ensuring that the DNA replication can happen bidirectional. So when the helicase activity becomes or the helicase activity is observed, then this MCM27 will open in this direction, while this MCM27 will open in this direction. So the orientation in which this MCM27 dimer is present in the replicator region is such that it ensures that both the helicases are able to open up the DNA in opposite directions, thereby ensuring the bidirectionality of the DNA replication. Now we go to the next interconnected step. So we know that for firing, the lysing step is important. So once the lysing step has been done, the firing is possible. So let us look at what is firing. So we are at a stage where the origins have been marked by the pre-replicative complex. So once the pre-replicative complexes are there and the cell moves from the G1 to the S phase, there are two important kinases that get active. These are cell cycle regulators. So this is the S, that is S phase cyclin, S cyclin CDK, and this is what is called as DB4 dependent kinase. Both of these kinases have an important role to play in firing of the origins. Let us look at how it is done. So what is first observed is that the DDK, that is the DB4 dependent kinase, phosphorylates the CDT1. This is a very important step for several reasons. But the most important reason is that this is how it is ensured that replication does not begin all over again, or there is no re-replication of DNA in the same cell cycle. So we all know that CDT1 is the replicating lysing factor, because it is the molecule that loads the MCM27, which is the helicase, onto the replicator region. Now, when CDT1 is phosphorylated, its affinity to bind to the MCM27 is lost, and so it moves off. So now, all the CDT1 that is present would be in the phosphorylated region, phosphorylated form, thanks to the DB4 dependent kinase. So effectively, the phosphorylation of CDT1 ensures that no more CDT1 can bind to any MCM27 that is present in the nucleus. So therefore, the CDT1 in the phosphorylated form will no longer be able to load any other MCM27 on the DNA at any of the origins. So thereby, once you already have the pre-replicative complex formed, you cannot have this origin being bound to by another pre-replicative complex. Why? Because the CDT1 gets phosphorylated and it cannot load the helicase. Now, interestingly, the CDT1 when phosphorylated can also get ubiquitinated, and with ubiquitination, the levels of CDT1 decreases. So that is another thing that happens, or regulation that happens, is CDT1, the concentration or the amount or the number of CDT1 itself decreases. What is also important to note over here is this, that there is a molecule called geminin, and CDT1 has a binding domain for geminin. So when geminin binds to CDT1, again CDT1 is not able to bind to the helicase. So therefore, geminin acts as the inhibitor of CDT1, such that CDT1 cannot bind to helicase, and therefore it can no longer load any other helicase onto the origins. Moreover, there is one more point of regulation, and that is whatever MCM27 that has not been loaded onto the origins are present in the nucleus, they all are exported out through the nuclear pore complex into the cytosol. So the levels of MCM27 in the nucleus is also going to go down. All these things together ensure that there cannot be firing of the origin again. Once it has happened, but you cannot have origin firing again. So therefore, this step is extremely important. And at this point, we know that due to phosphorylation of the CDT1, it leaves the pre-replicative complex. What is also observed is because of the kinase, you also have the CDC6, okay, getting phosphorylated. And in the phosphorylated form, its binding to the ORC is weakened, and thereby CDC6 as a phosphorylated form also goes away. So you can see this is another control point. Because there is no CDC6 present over here any longer, even if there is a CDT1 that is associated with MCM27, it cannot come and bind to the origin because now CDC6 is not present. So this is a regulation point for ensuring that firing does not happen from the same origin, again in the same cell cycle. So this is what is happening with the first kinase activate. Now let us see what also happens is because of the kinase, you will see that MCM2, 4 and 6, okay, are getting phosphorylated. The moment the MCM27 is phosphorylated, its conformation changes a little, although it is still not able or it is still not having an active helicase property. So its conformation changes in such a way that its binding to the replicator is good even without the presence of CDC6 and CDT1. So that also is important. And secondly, the phosphorylation of the MCM27 makes it ready to bind to many more other proteins. So what happens next is that you have SLD proteins, especially SLD3 and SLD7. These SLD 3 and 7 have binding sites for another molecule called CDC45. So it is the SLD proteins that will bind to CDC45, okay, one each. So SLD 3 will bind to CDC45, SLD 7 will also bind to CDC45. And together, they would load the CDC45 onto the helicase. Interestingly, the CDC45 binds to the helicase at the interface between MCM2 and MCM5. So the open ring is open between MCM2 and MCM5. Now, when CDC45 binds to the interface between MCM2 and MCM5, it is actually getting the helicase ready to close or get into a close conformation. Not just as yet, but it is ready. Because the CDC45 that is needed to make it active has come and bound. But it is only one of the molecules that makes it fully active. Thereafter, what happens is that the SLD2, SLD3 that is present and also SLD7 that is present get phosphorylated by S-cycline CDK. So when the SLD2, SLD3 are phosphorylated, you have a protein called DPB11 that comes and binds to the SLD. Okay, so when DPB11 comes and binds, okay, this DPB11 that comes and binds to the SLD in turn is able to bind to many other proteins. So you can say that it becomes a scaffold for bringing in many other proteins next. Now, let us therefore understand the DPB11. Also, of course, it helps the SLD and CDC45 to anchor with the helicase. So it increases the affinity with which the CDC45 and SLD bind to the helicase. Now let's look at what happens next. So there are many reports that suggest that at this point, you would have the next molecular constituent coming into picture, which is genes. What is genes? Genes is nothing but Go, Ichi, Ni, San. This stands for 5, 1, 3, 2. So basically, 5312. So basically, what is important is these subunits are go, ichi, ni, san. And this is SLD5, this is PSF1, this is PSF2, and this is PSF3. So this gins, again, because it has several subunits, can bind to several other molecules. So you can see that the replisome machinery is only going to become bigger and bigger, because every molecule that is now being added has the ability to bind to several other constituents. Another thing that is important to note over here is both gins and DPB11 are also able to bind to single-stranded DNA. So the understanding being that when helicase opens up the DNA and a single-stranded DNA is formed, it can also bind to the single-stranded DNA. So it definitely remains as part of the replisome machinery. So gins has binding sites for both DPB11 and CDC45. So it can bind to CDC45, it can also bind to DPB11. So you can see that the gins has come and bound to the initial complex where you already have the CDC45, okay, and you have the SLD proteins. This is what forms the next complex that is called as the CMG complex. C standing for CDC45, M standing for MCM27, and G standing for gins. This CMG complex that is formed is considered to be the pre-initiation or loading complex. Pre-initiation or pre-loading complex, that is how it is. And this is considered to be an intermediate in the firing stage. You see, the firing has not yet happened. The firing will end only with the DNA opening up. And as of now, the DNA has not yet opened up. But yes, the CDC45 and the gins together is going to make the open helicase into a closed helicase. So the gins and the CDC45 have now made the helicase into a closed complex, and as a closed complex, the MCM27 can act as the helicase. Now, please note over here that the DPB11 is able to interact with, DPB2. And this DPB2 is a component of the DNA polymerase epsilon. So the binding of the DPB2 to DPB11 is considered to be more of an architectural need, but it is important to note over here is that the DNA pol epsilon is now ready and can bind to the replisome machinery. Okay, so effectively the DNA pol epsilon is already ready for the synthesis of DNA after the DNA opens up. So now we look at the conversion of pre-IC, that is pre-initiation complex or the pre-loading complex, to final replication complex. So there are reports that suggest that once you have the CMG complex formed, the C, G, and M together form a very stable complex. So at this point, there are studies that suggest that SLD proteins may leave the complex, but there are some studies that suggest they may continue to be part of the system. Now, to this complex, that is the CMG complex, comes and binds to the binds the next constituent, which is MCM10. MCM10 can be a monomer, or can be a hexamer, or can be a trimer, or can be a tetramer. So it can vary from one species to other in the form that it is present in. But again, MCM10 is responsible for being able to bind to several different molecules. So therefore, MCM10 has a binding site. In fact, it can bind to all the subunits of the MCM27 complex. It can bind to gins. It can also bind to CDC45. So when it binds to the CMG complex, it is binding in such a way that it has an interaction with the MCM, it has an interaction with CDC45, it also has an interaction with the gins. So as mentioned, it can bind to MCM2-7, it can also bind to DNA polymerase. Therefore, it remains part of the replisome complex as long as replication happens. MCM10, MCM27, gins, CDC45 as a complex is responsible for unwinding the DNA. And so the moment MCM10 comes and binds, it splits the two helicases in such a way that the independent helicases are able to begin unwinding the DNA in the 3 prime to 5 prime direction. So you can see now that the CMG, when attached to by MCM10, can begin to unwind the DNA. So a replication bubble has formed. Now, to this replication bubble, okay, the two regions, that is this as well as this, is now ready. In fact, they're already bound to DNA polymerases, but they are further ready to bind to the other nuclear replicative DNA polymerases as well. So what's observed is that the GINs can bind to DNA polymerase alpha, and it can also bind to the CF4 domain of the RPA. RPA is nothing but equivalent to the single strand binding protein that is present in the prokaryotes, and RPA can bind cooperatively to the single-stranded DNA that is formed to stabilize the replication bubble. But what is important first is that the DNA pol alpha comes and binds to both the GINs as well as the CF4. Once you have the DNA pol alpha coming and binding, we all know that DNA pol alpha has two subunits of polymerase and has two subunits of primase. So therefore, DNA pol alpha will initiate the formation of the primer, okay, to form the primer template junction, and the polymerase subunits of the DNA pol alpha itself begins to extend the DNA or form the DNA from the primer. So effectively, at a primer template junction, it is DNA pol alpha that begins to form the DNA or synthesize the DNA. So with the primer template junction formed, the DNA pol alpha is also synthesizing, or using the 3' OH of the primer, it is starting to synthesize the DNA. But it cannot continue to synthesize the DNA because it does not have the 3', 5' exonuclease activity, and so it cannot carry out proofreading. Therefore, it is an error-prone replication that is carried out by DNA pol alpha, and hence it can only just initiate the formation of the DNA but cannot continue to synthesize. Moreover, the DNA pol alpha also does not have high processivity, or it is not bound to with greater affinity to pcna, so that we will see. So the work of the DNA pol alpha, of course, is to initiate formation of the primer template junction and the leading strand first. So this, for this replication fork, this is the leading strand, and for this replication fork, this is the leading strand. Then we know that DNA pol epsilon is already bound to the DPB11. So this DNA pol epsilon is going to have a stronghold onto the double-stranded DNA that is formed by the DNA pol alpha because of the loading of the PCNA, that is the proliferative cell nuclear antigen, which is equivalent to the beta clamp. And it is the RFC, that is replication factor C, that is loading the PCNA on this primer template junction per se. Once that has been loaded, the PCNA attached to the pol epsilon is able to synthesize the DNA on the leading strand. Now, next what happens, of course, is that the remaining single-stranded DNA is protected and also stabilized by the RPA, which is equivalent to the single-strand binding protein. Now, what also happens next is that as the leading strand has been begun to be synthesized by the DNA pol epsilon, okay, this DNA pol alpha is jumping from the leading strand to the lagging strand. Okay, thanks to its connectivity with the genes and the CF4 domain of the RPA. So once it binds to the lagging strand, it forms the primer template junction and also extends it to a certain extent before the replication factor C, RFC, loads the PCNA, and onto this PCNA is then loaded the DNA pol delta. So the DNA pol delta will synthesize now the DNA in the lagging strand. So from this point on, it will synthesize in this direction. And from this point on, this DNA pol delta will synthesize in this direction. So what is characteristic of eukaryotic DNA replication is that you have two distinct DNA polymerases that synthesize the leading and the lagging strand, unlike in the prokaryotic system, where you have the same DNA polymerase synthesizing both the leading and the lagging strand. But in this, you have two different polymerases that are involved in synthesizing the two strands, that is the leading and the lagging strand. And you have DNA pol alpha that acts as a primase and also a polymerase. So this is replisome machinery at one replication factor, and this is the replisome machinery at the other replication factor, with the understanding that as the fork moves, the entire replisome machinery is going to move as well. So let us conclude. In eukaryotes, the initiation of replication is divided into two interconnected steps. Each takes place in two different phases of the cell cycle, one in the G1 and one in the S phase. And this ensures that DNA is not replicated in the same cell cycle. The formation of the pre-replicative complex in the G1 phase is the licensing step, wherein the ORC, CDC6 and the CDT1 mark the origins and load the inactive helicase. In the G1S transition, two cell cycle regulators, the DB4 dependent kinase and the S cyclin CDK, initiate the firing process, which ensures that the pre-replicative complex is converted to the pre-IC, that is pre-initiation complex, and then on binding with MCM10, the pre-initiation complex is converted to the replication complex. The replisomes at each replication fork comprises the three nuclear replicative DNA polymerases, which initiate the formation of the primer template junction, and therefore thereafter addition of PCNA to enable DNA polymerase switching and also to enable synthesis of the leading and the lagging strand. Thus, initiation of replication is a tightly regulated molecular mechanism with a highly coordinated complex machinery that comes together to ensure that replication occurs only once in a cell cycle. Thank you.